Man, so good to be in God's house together. Just want to welcome everyone, whether you're joining us in person or you're watching online. Man, it's an honor to have you with us. And then I get the privilege every single week of being able to look into the camera and welcome all the men and women joining us from our correctional ministry out of Lucas County Corrections and the Correction Center of Northwest Ohio. We love you guys. Come on, Defiance. Help me welcome my church family today. So good. Well, today we are in week number 2 of a series we kicked off last week called We Can't Stay Here. And last week we talked about how God not only gives us the desire to not stay where we're at, but he gives us the ability to go to a place we've never been before. Two. And so if you didn't get a chance to be here with us last week, I'd highly recommend to you to go online, watch that message as we talked about some things we need to know and understand about the role the Holy Spirit plays in our lives and in our journey with him. And today, as we kind of continue the conversation, let's take a look at our theme scripture for this entire series, Philippians chapter 3, starting in verse 12. And the Apostle Paul is speaking here, and he says, I'm not saying that I have it all together, that I've made it, that I've arrived at my destination, but I'm well on my way. I'm growing, I'm learning, I'm moving forward because I know I can't stay where I'm at. I know there's God more that God has for me. I know there's more that God wants to do in my life. Therefore, I'm reaching out for Christ who has so wondrously reached out for me. I'm so glad he reached out for me. He says, friends, don't get me wrong. By no means do I count myself an expert in all of this. I don't have it all figured out, but I've got my eye on the goal where God is beckoning, where God is inviting us onward to Jesus. I'm off and running, and I'm not turning back. In other words, Paul is telling us, I don't always know where I'm going, but the one thing I do know is I'm not going back to where I've already been. And since that's the case, let's keep focused on that. That goal, those of us who want everything that God has for us. You know, that's really what this series is all about. Not staying where we're at because we want all that God has for us. And the title of the message today is When Life Gets Hard. When life gets hard. Last week we were inspired, like, let's go. We're taking the mountain. We're taking Chipotle. Let's do this thing. And this week, we're talking about when life gets hard. You know, something that I've discovered is that whenever we step out in faith to go where God is calling us to go, there are always difficulties, adversity, and problems along the way. In other words, we could just say this, that problems are a part of the process. And the truth is, all of us are either in the middle of a problem right now, we're just coming out of a problem, or there's a problem waiting for us around the corner. Oh, Pastor, can't you be more positive? I mean, we're in church. Absolutely. I'm positive. All of us are either in the middle of a problem, just coming out of a problem, or there's a problem waiting for us around the corner. Because whenever we decide we can't stay here and we step out in faith to go to a place we've never been, to go to the place God is calling us to go, we can expect there's going to be some difficulties. There's going to be some adversity. There's going to be some problems along the way. I mean, we see this throughout the Bible, don't we? We see this with Moses. God comes and he calls Moses to go to a place he'd never been before, to lead God's people out of slavery and bondage and oppression. And what does Moses tell God? Man, I can't do it. And his insecurities had all the reasons why you should choose someone else, God. And eventually God talks him into doing what he was calling him to do. And so Moses goes where God's calling him to go. He goes to Pharaoh, right? The ruler of Egypt. And he says, hey, God told me to tell you to let his people go. And if you know the story, did his life get easier or harder? harder, right? Did the Israelites, God's people, have more problems or less problems? They had more problems. Pharaoh turned up the heat on them, was more abusive, took away their resource, but then upped the quota and what they were supposed to, the bricks they were supposed to. Life didn't get easier. Life got, wait a minute, God, you told me to do this. I stepped out in faith. I went where you wanted me to go, and life didn't get easier. It got harder. But then what did God eventually do? Came through, right? He used their problems to push them into their purpose, right? Brought 10 plagues, parted the Red Sea. They walked over on dry ground into the wilderness, right? Where they would spend 40 years on this two-week journey learning how to trust and depend on God. I know they get a bad rap that it took them 40 years to go 2 weeks. I just wonder how long it would take some of us. I think it took me 80 years because the whole goal of the wilderness was for them to learn how to trust and depend completely on God. To not continue to make things happen on their own and rely upon their own strength. I might still be in the wilderness trying to learn that lesson, right? So they spend 40 years wandering through the wilderness, and then they come to the edge of the Jordan River, right? And at this point, there's been a changing of the guard. Moses is no longer leading God's people. Now it's Joshua. Joshua chapter 1, God comes to Joshua. What's he tell him? Be strong and courageous because I've called you, Joshua, to lead my people into the promised land, to cross the Jordan River and to go into the promised land, to go to a place you've never been before. So Joshua, full of faith, full of courage, leads the Israelites, God's people, cross the Jordan River into the promised land. And did life get easier for the Israelites or harder? Harder. Did they have more problems or less problems when they crossed the Jordan? They had more problems. I would suggest to us, it would have been easier for them to stay where they were at. Now, they never would have experienced all that God had for them. They never had to go through all the difficulties and the adversity and the problems. But the Bible tells us, I believe in Joshua chapter 7, that as they crossed the Jordan River, they would have to fight 31 kings and their armies and defeat them in battle in order to take possession of the very place God had already prepared for them. God told them, I'm giving this to you, now go and take it. And when they stepped out in faith, there wasn't less problems, there was more problems. We even see this with Jesus, don't we? When Jesus gets water baptized by John the Baptist, that was pretty fitting there, right? When age 30, and the Bible tells us that the heavens open up, the Holy Spirit descends in the form of a dove, the voice of the Father speaks and said, this is my Son whom I'm well pleased. And Jesus starts his public ministry. What's he do next? He goes into the desert, into the wilderness to fast for 40 days and 40 nights. And what happens? The enemy of our soul, Satan himself, comes and tempts him and tries to get him to quit and to give up and to renounce and to not do the very thing the Father had sent him to do. Why? Because whenever we step out in faith to go to that very place God is calling us to go, there's always going to be difficulties. There's always going to be adversity. There's always going to be problems along the way. It's just problems are just a part of the process. I can remember when I was interning at a church back when 20 years ago, I was interning at a church. God had called me. I just felt to go into full-time ministry And so my next step was to go and intern this church to get discipled and kind of learn the little ropes of ministry. And so I remember during the internship, one of the things we did a lot of serving in the community. And this was in Blue Springs, Missouri, a suburb of Kansas City. And one of the things we did was a lot of serving, a lot of outreaches in the community. And so us interns came up with a game that whenever we were done with an outreach or serving, we would race back to the church to see who could get back there the fastest. And so I can remember one time in particular, I was driving with a bunch of interns in my vehicle. I was rolling my 1996 teal green Buick Regal, basically a race car for the elderly that I was sporting. Come on, somebody. Had the chrome luggage rack just for more aerodynamics, right? Just keep me stuck on the road. And I packed that thing of interns. And then my buddy Steve was driving his Dodge Intrepid. And he was packed that full of interns. And so we went out in the community and we were serving. And we got done. We jumped in our cars to race back to the church. Well, Steve got a head start on me. And so I was behind him. And the whole way I was trying to get around him, but I was trying to get around him in a Christian internship. sort of way, right? This is 20 years ago, just so you know. But the problem was Steve knew all that shortcuts that I knew. So he knew all the back alleyways, how we cut behind businesses and cut through yards, all kinds of things to get back to the church. I mean, it was for real, for real. And so I just couldn't get around Steve. So finally we came to the street the church was located on. And just to give you context, the church was at the end of a dead end, right? Dead end street. And so on the left-hand side of the street was a bunch of houses. On the right-hand side was an open field. The church was down on the right-hand side of the dead end, and the parking lot was on the right-hand side. So we turn on the street. I have little time to think in this moment. I basically one option, but I'll give you two just for the sake of the sermon today. I had two options. Take the loss. How many thought I took the loss? You know your pastor well. I didn't even think that was an option. So that's a fake option. The second option was to jump the curb and to haul it through this field as fast as I could. And one of the beautiful things about the church was there was no like parking cement slabs or anything like that. There was a smooth transition from field to blacktop to parking lot. So it was perfect for that race that day for me to get the victory. And so I am hauling through the field. I think maybe 70, I don't even know. I was barely saved at this point, guys. This is 20 years ago. I'd never do anything like that now. I'd go like 30 or 40, but I would never go like 70 now. And so I am hauling through the field. I get to the church parking lot. I hit him. You know, I'm halfway, you know, in a parking spot. We jump out, all of us interns. We're going nuts, you know, only to see Steve pull in and his slow, intrepid into the parking lot. And we're going nuts. I'm giving Steve the guns. How does second place feel, sucker? You know, we are going off, celebrating the victory. And in the middle of my celebration, I look over at the church only to realize the entire pastoral staff is standing at the front glass doors watching this entire thing go down. And you know what I had at that moment? I had a problem. I had a big problem, people, right? Real big problem. How many of us know that some of the problems that come into our lives are out of our control, but others are created? That day I had created some problems in my life. But the truth is, man, all of us have problems, don't we? Problems in our relationships, problems in our finances. There's problem at school, there's problem at work, there's problems in our health, man. Problems are just a part of life, aren't they? I love what John Maxwell says in his book, Change Your World. He says this. He says, a mistake that we so often make is walking away from a relationship, an occupation, a church, or even a dream because of a problem. So often we leave too early, not realizing there's not just problems where we are, but also where we're going. Right, problems are just a part of life. I got problems now, but if I walk away from this, there's gonna be problems over there too. They're just a part of us. Everyone has them. And if you're taking notes today, I want you to write this down, and that is this: that problems can either sabotage or strengthen our faith. Problems can either sabotage or strengthen our faith. And I think it's important for us to understand that it's not if we have problems, but instead how we respond to them that determine our success or failure in life. Have you noticed that our problems never leave us the same? That, for example, a right response to our problems can cause us to progress and move forward and to overcome what's in front of us. But a wrong response to our problems can actually drive us backwards, to cause us to go the wrong way, that we can either advance or we can retreat. And I think if we're really honest with ourselves, we've all found ourselves on both sides of that coin, haven't we? Like, for example, we've had maybe some problems come into our lives and something on the inside of us just rose up and we're like, I'm not backing down from this thing. I'm not running from it. I'm running through this thing. God, you have done too much and you have brought me too far to leave me now. And all of a sudden, something on the inside, faith rose up on the inside of us and our faith is strengthened. But then we've all had those moments where our problems come into our lives and just the opposite happened on the inside of us. We got discouraged. We felt defeated. Maybe we said things like, I don't know if anything could ever be different than the way things are right now in my life. We start to lose hope, and our faith seems really, really small. Today, I want to talk to us about when we find ourselves in that place. Like when life gets hard, when our problems seem overwhelming and we feel like, man, I don't know if my marriage is going to make it. Like I thought at one point it was, but now there's some issues. I don't know if we're going to make it. Maybe things can't be different. Maybe I got some problems in my finances. I thought we were going to get out of debt. And all of a sudden this broken, that broken. God, I don't know if I can make it. I don't know. Or maybe even in our relationship with God, I'm trying to live a godly life. I'm trying to do what he wants me to do, but I find myself going back to places I've already been. I'm just in that place of discouragement, starting to lose hope, and I'm kind of questioning, man, can life even be different? And the truth is, life has just become hard. If you find yourself in that place today, I want you to know you're not alone. You're not alone. And the guy we're gonna study a character in the Bible today by a guy by the name of Habakkuk. Everybody say Habakkuk. Kazuntai, right? And Habakkuk was a prophet in the Old Testament of the Bible. Habakkuk actually wrote a book in the Old Testament that was named after him, Habakkuk, right? And what's interesting about Habakkuk is that he was a prophet, but he didn't do what prophets were called to do. You see, a prophet in the Old Testament was called to speak to God's people on God's behalf. But Habakkuk did just the opposite. He actually spoke to God on behalf of the people. What's interesting, Habakkuk, he wrote the book 600 years before the birth of Christ, 600 years B.C. And really, the whole theme of the book is Habakkuk trying to hold on to his faith in the midst of all of these problems that he's facing. I think we can all relate to feeling like that in one way, shape, or form. In fact, the entire book starts off with this kind of this conversation, this argument, if you will, between Habakkuk and God. Habakkuk has two complaints that he's bringing before God, and how many of us know God has two responses for Habakkuk? And it starts off his first complaint. He comes before God, and life has just gotten hard. People are drifting from God. There's violence and injustices taking place. They're dealing with corrupt leadership and politicians. Am I talking about 600 BC or am I talking about 2021, right? Sound familiar? All these problems are happening. The world seems to be falling apart. There's issues, and Habakkuk is crying out to God. He's asking God for help, but he's not getting the answers when he wants or how he wants. And so let's take a look at his first complaint. Habakkuk chapter 1, verse 2 through 3. Habakkuk talking to God. He says, how long, Lord? You ever talk like that to God? How long, God? Must I call for help, but you don't listen? Or cry out to you, violence, but you don't save? Why do you make me look at injustice? Why do you tolerate wrongdoing? Destruction and violence are before me. There is strife and conflict abounds. You know, what I love about Habakkuk is that he's just raw. He's just real. This is where I'm at, God. I'm trying to have faith. I'm trying to believe, but I look around and I don't understand why I'm going through what I'm going through. Have you ever complained like this to God? And I love the fact that Habakkuk is just being open and honest with God and what's really happening in his heart. What's interesting is that Habakkuk's name actually tells his story. And my hope is, and my prayer is, that it would tell our story too. If you're taking notes, the name Habakkuk literally means to embrace or to wrestle. To embrace or to wrestle. Habakkuk is doing everything that he can to embrace who he knows God is, but because what he sees doesn't line up with what he believes, he's wrestling with his reality. God, I know you're good, but yet what I'm going through isn't good. But God, I know you're in control, and all you got to do is say the word, but yet it doesn't seem like anything's happening, God. Like, so I know I'm struggling. I'm embracing who you are, but I'm wrestling with my reality. I'm wrestling with my problem. I'm wrestling with my struggle. And he's in this place to embrace and wrestle. What do we do when our faith seems small? When life gets hard and when our problems seem overwhelming and we feel like giving up and we feel like walking away from the very place God is calling us to be. Walking away from a marriage because it seems easier, right? Walking away from a dream because we've gotten so discouraged we've lost hope. Walking back to an addiction, or maybe even walking away from God. I want to challenge us today that instead of walking away, instead of giving up, that we would embrace and wrestle so that our faith is strengthened, not sabotaged by our problems. Now, I get it. I understand that comment might get some amens, but it's so much easier said than done, right? Well, that was the case for Habakkuk too. So let's take a look. Habakkuk chapter 1, verse 5. Let's take a look at how God responds to his first complaint. God looks at him and says, well, look at the nations and watch and be utterly amazed, for I am going to do something in your days, Habakkuk, that you wouldn't even believe, even if you were told. In other words, God is saying to him, I'm going to use your problems to push you into your purpose. Now, that's good, isn't it? But how many know that's not fun? Because that's not the prayer. That's not what Habakkuk's asking for. What's he asking for? What most of us do. God, take my problems away, right? I'm not comfortable. I'm going through hell. God, get me out of here. Like, deliver me. Freedom. That's what I'm asking. And God says, no, I'm not going to take it away. I'm going to use it. I'm going to use it. I'm going to use your problem. I'm going to use your pain to actually push you into your purpose. How many of us know that God has this innate ability to work all things together for the good, even our problems? And so take a look at what God tells Habakkuk next in verse 6 of chapter 1. He says, I'm going to raise up the Babylonians. Just so we're all on the same page, the Babylonians were God's people's enemy. I'm going to use your enemy, the very people that hate you, that oppress you, that attack you, that come against you. I'm going to use your enemy to bring justice and freedom and deliverance in your life. That ruthless and impetuous people who sweep across the whole earth to seize dwellings not their own, and they are feared and dreaded people. They are a law to themselves and promote their own honor. Can you imagine how Habakkuk walked away from this conversation? Like, oh, God, yeah. Thanks, God. In fact, we're not going to study it today, but I'll just reference it. You know what Habakkuk's second complaint is in this book? You're going to do what? You're going to use who? The Babylonians? And actually, Habakkuk's second complaint is him complaining about how God's answering his first complaint. Hold up. That's not what I was asking for, God. I was asking for something different. I don't like how you're answering my first complaint. God looks at him and says, you think it's bad now, bro? It's going to get worse. But I'm going to use your enemies. I'm going to use your problems to bring about justice. And this is just, it's hard for Habakkuk to understand. How many know it's really hard to have the right perspective when you're in the middle of the problem? Like, it doesn't make sense. It doesn't feel right. I don't understand. What do we do when we find ourselves in this place? We wrestle and we embrace. We wrestle with this tension of not understanding, but we embrace a faith in God that knows that his thoughts are higher than our thoughts and his ways are higher than our ways. And so in the rest of our time together, I want to give us three ways that we can wrestle and embrace so that our faith can be strengthened, not sabotaged by our problems. And so if you're taking notes, the first way that we wrestle and embrace so that our faith is strengthened. Number one is that my faith is strengthened in God's presence. My faith is strengthened in God's presence. I want us to notice that even in his questions, even in his doubts, even in his complaints, even when Habakkuk didn't understand or even agree with what God was doing, Habakkuk still ran to God's presence. Notice he's not complaining to his friends. He's not posting his frustration on social media. Come on, somebody. He's going to God to with his doubt, and he's trying to embrace a greater faith. Some might think, well, can we, you know, when we talked about complaining to God, like, have you ever complained like that to God? Have you ever talked to God like that? Some of us might think, no, there's no, you can't talk to God like that. You can't. That's disrespect. That's dishonor. There's no reverence in that. But how many know God can handle our questions? He can handle our doubts. The issue is, I'll talk about this here in a second. The issue is that we go to him with those complaints. We come to him with those problems, with those doubts. So Habakkuk is in this middle of this wrestling and embracing, wrestling with the tension of not understanding, but trying to embrace who he knows God is. Let's take a look at how he does this in verse 12 and 13 of Habakkuk chapter 1. Let's take a look. He says, Lord, are you not from everlasting? He's embracing. God, I know you're not of this world. I know you spoke the heavens and the earth into existence. I know you're God. I know you're not from everlasting. I'm embracing who you are. My God, my Holy One, you will never die. I'm embracing who you are. You, Lord, have appointed them to execute judgment. I'm wrestling, God. I don't understand that you would choose the Babylonians to bring about justice, our enemy. I'm wrestling, not understanding you, my rock. I'm embracing though who you are. You've ordained them to punish, and I'm wrestling how you're doing it. I'm wrestling with your plan. Verse 13, your eyes are too pure to look on evil. I'm embracing your greatness. I'm embracing who you are. You cannot tolerate wrongdoing. I'm embracing it. Why then do you tolerate the treacherous? But I'm wrestling. I'm wrestling with what's happening. Why are you silent while the wicked swallow up those more righteous than themselves? I'm wrestling. I'm wrestling with the tension. I'm trying to embrace, but I'm wrestling with the tension. God, I just want us to know, God understands our problems and he welcomes our questions. That we don't walk away when there's tension. We don't walk away when we don't understand. We don't walk away when we don't even agree. We wrestle. We wrestle. We wrestle. When we face problems, God doesn't want us to deny our doubts, but instead we let our doubts drive us to continue to embrace our faith in God, even when we don't understand. I'm wrestling. Can I just tell you, this is a great recipe for a marriage. Isn't it? That there's going to be tension, there's going to be problems, but I'm not going anywhere. I'm not going to walk away from this thing. I'm going to embrace who I know that you are, that we're on the side, that we two people love each other. But I'm wrestling with our problems. I'm wrestling with the tension that we have between us, but I'm not going anywhere. Our faith is strengthened in God's presence because it's in his presence I'm reminded that my problems might be big, but my God is bigger. He's bigger. And so how do we get into God's presence? First, we see it through Habakkuk, right? The whole book. Through prayer. How do I get into God's presence? Through prayer. I think Habakkuk gives us the perfect way to pray when we're in the midst of our struggles. When they're amidst all of our problems. God, I don't agree. I don't like this. Some of my most powerful times in prayer with God have been me coming to him and telling him, I'm wrestling. I don't understand, God. It doesn't make sense to me. Why did my dad have to die, God? Why didn't he get a chance to meet my kids? Why did he never get to see me out of a jail cell? I don't get it, God. I don't understand, God. I'm wrestling, but I know who you are. I know you work all things together for the good. I know you bring purpose out of anything, God. So I still trust you. I still believe in you. I'm wrestling, right? Prayer, right? I'm wrestling in this prayer. I would suggest that some of us need to pray like this. I'm not going anywhere. I'm wrestling. But how many of us know prayer is not just us talking to God, it's him talking to us. So when I'm talking about prayer, I'm not just complaining to God. Notice Habakkuk, he brought some complaints, but the whole thing wasn't just him complaining and dumping on God. Here's where I'm at. Now I'm going to shut my mouth. What do you have to say, God? That's prayer. God, here's where I'm at, but God, speak to me. I'm listening. Speak to me. I need to hear your voice. Right? So we get into God's presence through prayer. We get into God's presence by opening up the truth of his word, right? Another way he speaks to us is the truth of his word. And we like to say around here, don't just read the Bible, let the Bible read you. The Bible tells us that it's like a mirror. It's like a reflection to us. It shows us if we got any boogers in our noses, right? Shows us. Sorry. You know, sometimes they just come to you. You should just keep it, right? Like, just keep that in, bro. Just don't think it, but don't say it. But it shows us our flaws, right? Hopefully we all, before we came to church today, we took some time and looked in the mirror. I saw a couple of you in the lobby. I don't know if you did that. I'm just saying. I'm joking. It was more than a couple. I'm teasing, right? But a mirror shows us, oh man, this needs fixed. Oh man, this off, or this looks good, right? A mirror, that's what the word of God reflects to us, areas of our heart that need his truth. Now I've gotten off course. This problem has, I've started to grab a hold of some lies. I've started to grab a hold of some doubt. I've started to grab a hold of some hopelessness. I've started to grab a hold of all the reasons why it can't work instead of the one reason it can. His name is Jesus. Let me get back into his word and grab a hold of the truth of God's word. Get in God's presence by reading his word. That's why it's so important for us to read and pray every single day. Not to be religious, because I need to get into his presence. And his presence is the fullness of joy. I need more joy. All right? Another way we can get into God's presence is by coming to God's house. Coming into God's house and worshiping the name that's above every name. Jesus even said, where two or three are gathered together in my name, there I will be among them. Something powerful happens when we gather together in this place and we lift our hands and we sing in one accord, King Jesus. All of a sudden, faith starts to arise. Hope starts to arise, right? Our problems seem small because I'm reminding myself of how big my God is. Now, when our praises go up, man, his presence comes down. So the first way we can kind of strengthen our faith is by getting into God's presence. The second way, if you're taking notes, that we can wrestle and embrace in the midst of our problems so that our faith is strengthened. Number two is that my faith is strengthened with God's people. With God's people. It's interesting that Habakkuk is wrestling with his doubt and embracing his faith in God's presence, but then he makes this statement in Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 1. He says, I will climb up to my watchtower. Let me work on getting back to that place where I can have eyes to see and ears to hear God's voice. I referenced it earlier that how many of us know it's really hard to have the right perspective when we find ourselves in the middle of a problem. That's why it's so important for us to surround ourselves with the right people. The Bible tells us in the multitude of many counselors, there's much wisdom. And if you just read these three chapters, I think you'll miss this passage of scripture because he says, I'm going to get back to my watchtower and I'm going to stand at my guard post. I'm going to take my place back amongst God's people. This, have you noticed that problems often push us away from God, away from God's people? Have you ever felt like, man, I just don't even want to go to small group. I don't even want to go to church because they're just going to ask me about that. There's a bunch of people that just, I just don't want to. And we distance and we isolate. How many of us know when we do that, our faith isn't strengthened, it's sabotaged. No, it's in those weak moments. It's in my problems. It's in my struggles when I need those people the most. It's not when I'm on the mountains, when I'm in the valley. I need those people encouraging me and come alongside me. That's what Habakkuk's saying, man. These problems have gotten me off course. Let me get back to the very place I need to be. There, in that place, I will wait and see what the Lord says and how he will answer my complaint. You see, our faith is strengthened with God's people. I'm convinced that I am where I am because of the people in my life. I mean, because if I'm really honest with you, I've been serving God for over 20 years. And the reality is there's been moments when I wanted to quit. There's been moments when I've felt discouraged. There's been moments when I felt defeated. There's been moments when I've said to myself, man, I just don't think anything can be different in my life. There's no way I can overcome this. There's no way this is going to happen. And I've been discouraged, and I felt like walking away from the very place God was calling me to be. But because I had some people who are in my life, they came alongside me and they had the faith for me. And they reached down and they picked me up in my sin, in my struggles, in my discouragement, in my problems. And they said, hey, we're going to walk with you through your pain, through your problems, and we're going to make sure that you get to the other side. How many of us know we all need people like that in our lives? People who are willing to walk with us through thick and through the thin moments of our lives. That's why I'm always talking about serving and small groups around here, because that's church community. How many of church is community, not a building? It's us getting to know each other. So if we just come in and we leave and we don't get to know anybody, are we a part of a community? No. And what happens when we face problems and struggles and issues? We feel like quitting. We don't have anybody to come alongside us and say, come on, get back up. I have the faith for you. It doesn't matter. I'm not going anywhere. I'll sit with you. I'll talk with you. I'll call you. I'll walk alongside you. You know, I speaking of small groups, I've just been blown away this semester in my men's small group that I lead. Just the men in my small group that man, what God's doing. And this past week we were just sharing who we are in Christ and some things God has done and where He's brought us from. And I just want to brag. I mean, all the guys, just amazing. But one guy in particular last week, his name's Matt. He was involved in a car accident 15 years ago and was paralyzed from the waist down. And doctors told him he would never be able to really be self-sufficient. He'd never be able to take care of himself. He'd have to be in a home, or he'd have to have somebody taking care of him all the time. He wouldn't be able to dress himself. He'd never be able to walk again. He'd never, ever be able to have a normal life again because of what happened. And he was sharing just the discouragement. Can you imagine the hopelessness of not being able to walk and not having a normal life? And all his dreams started to drift away in that moment. And he was telling us last week that God used that to actually lead him back to a relationship with Jesus. That God used his problem of that accident to bring him back into a relationship with him. And he said something inside of him was just determined. And even though the doctor said that he would never do this and never do that, he'd never walk again, he told us a story about he would go to physical therapy and they'd put some braces on his legs. And the first day he'd stand up and he'd just stand. He'd stand as maybe 30 seconds, as long as he could, and he'd fall back down in the wheelchair. And that's all he would do that day, just stand for 30 seconds. And the next day he'd go back and he'd stand for 45 seconds. And the next day he'd go back and he'd stand for a minute. And the next day he'd go back and he took his first step. The next day he'd go back, he would take a step and a half. And that's all he would do that day. And the next day he'd take two steps and three steps. And month after month and after years, he finally walked down to the nurse's station and all the way back. And doctor said, you're never gonna walk again. You're never going to be able to do that. And he said, that was just the beginning. Now he goes, now I'm fully self-dependent. I get dressed. All the things the doctor said I couldn't do, I'm overcoming those things. He goes, even though I'm still in a wheelchair, I'm not limited by this wheelchair. And he was sharing, check this out. This is the church. He was sharing this past week in small group. And he was sharing how he feels like God is calling him to inspire others. He goes, I feel like God wants to use my story to inspire other people who have disabilities or have been in car accidents and can't walk and they have all these other ailments and things they got to overcome. And I stopped him right in the middle of it. I said, no, hold up. Hold up, Matt. Why you got to limit yourself just to people who have disabilities? You're sitting in a room right now full, and you're the only one in a wheelchair. None of us have any physical disabilities. And I'm inspired that the problems I'm facing, because I look at what God's done in your life, that I can overcome them. Why limit yourself? And you see the church. How many know? In that moment, his faith went to another level, right? All of a sudden, he's going, wait a minute. Why would I limit God? And what God can, not just people who are disabled. I can inspire everybody with my story. And all of a sudden, his faith was strengthening my faith, and my faith was strengthening his faith, because our faith is strengthened with each other, with God's people. Finally, today, the third way we wrestle and embrace so that our faith is strengthened. Number three is that my faith is strengthened when I trust in God's plan. You see, it's when we surrender to God's plan. It's when we come to this point, guys, when we say, I don't understand. I don't understand God. How many know if you knew the plan, you wouldn't need God and you wouldn't need faith, right? I don't understand at all. It doesn't make sense. I don't even fully agree, God, but I don't have to, because I trust you. I trust you, God, and I trust your plan. When we come to that point in our lives, something changes on the inside of us. All of a sudden, the shift happens. And all of a sudden, doubt and defeat and discouragement and unbelief and hopelessness starts to fade, and faith and strength and courage starts to rise, because I know, God, your plan is better. And even though I don't understand, even though I don't get it, I still trust you. This is the place Habakkuk finally got to. In fact, the entire book ends, the end of chapter 3 ends with Habakkuk saying this. I love it. Habakkuk chapter 3, verse 17 through 19. He says, even though, I love this, even though the fig trees have no blossoms, and there are no grapes on the vines, and even though the olive crop fails, and the fields lie empty and barren, and even though the flocks die in the fields, and the cattle barns are empty, right? He just goes through all. So like, I love it. Isn't that life? Like, well, even though my finances are a mess, man, tension in my marriage, my job, holy cow, my boss, and even the one thing after another. But notice where he gets to in verse 18. Three words: yet I will. I think we all need a yet I will kind of faith. Yet I will. I think too often, if you're anything like me, I've made the mistake of going, well, this ain't happening, and that's not happening. I got this problem, and I got that problem, and this struggle, and this isn't going the way I wanted to go, and this isn't going how I thought, and I just sit there. And I never get to yet I will. We got to get to the yet I will. I got to trust in your plan, God. Yet I will rejoice. Yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in God, in the God of my salvation. I mean, joy doesn't come. Happiness is what's happening around us. Joy comes on the inside of us, right? I will be joyful, not because my situation is perfect, not because everything's going my way, but there's something on the inside of me that reminds myself, God, all the things you've done for me. Thank you for your salvation. Thank you for life. Thank you for victory. Thank you for freedom. And even if you don't fix this, I'm still good. Yet I will still praise my God. Yet I still will follow you. Yet I still will walk with you, not walk away from you, God. And he comes to this place. That's victory. I mean, now I can go to a place I've never been. Now I'm not going to quit and go back to where I've already been. I'm going to go. I'm going to see this thing through. And all of a sudden, I get on the other side of the Red Sea. I defeat those 31 kings. And I rise from the grave. And I see God do exceedingly abundantly, more than I could think, ask, or even imagine in and through my life. That is the journey God wants us to go on. The journey of faith. Amen? Would you pray with me today? Father, we love you in this place, God. We thank you for who you are. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your victory. We thank you for your presence. Right now, as we're praying together, with every head bowed and every eye closed, man, if you're here today, and you're just in that place of discouragement, you're just in that place of feeling defeated, man, I don't know. I had hope at one point, but I'm just struggling. I want you to know God sees you. Come on, hear that. God sees you. You're not alone. And if you're in that place of just struggle, can you just lift your hand? I want to pray for you right where you're at. Come on, just lift your hand up. Yeah. God, cry out to you today. We ask you for help, God. That you are our help in our time of need. We just declare that they might be out of faith, but that we would join our faith together as one body, as one church, as one accord. That we would remind ourselves of who you are, that our problems might be big, but our God is bigger. God, I pray that faith would arise in this place. I pray your presence would fill your sons and your daughters. I pray that we would connect ourselves with God's people in maybe a way we haven't ever before. And that we would come to this place like Habakkuk, where we just choose to trust in your plan. And as we do, God, I pray you would strengthen our faith. We're not walking away, we're wrestling. We're embracing and we're wrestling, but we're not going anywhere. God, I pray that you would move. And I pray that you would just remind us that we're not alone. that your ways are higher than our ways, your thoughts are higher than ours, and we trust you. Strengthen your sons and your daughters today. As we continue praying, maybe you're here and you've never come to that point of just saying, here's my life, God. Talking about God's plan, maybe you've never just said, God, I trust your plan for my life. I surrender it to you. I'm gonna live a God-first life. Forgive me of my sin. Thank you for the price Jesus paid on the cross. Here's my life, Jesus. If you need to make that decision, whether you're joining us in person or watching online, would you just lift your hand to heaven, wherever you're at? Maybe you're on your couch, on break at work, or sitting in this room. Would you just lift your hand and say, here I am, God. I want to know you. I want to have a relationship with you, not just to know about you, but to know your grace and your love and your freedom and your life. And right where you're at, would you just pray this where they say, God, thank you. Thank you for your son, Jesus, who paid the price for my sin on the cross. God, here's my life. I take a step of faith today. I have all the reasons why I can't, but I'm grabbing a hold. I'm embracing the one reason I can, Jesus. God, here's my life. Forgive me of my sin. Fill me with your spirit. Show me how to live, God. My life is yours. In Jesus' name. And everybody said,